Morning. So today I'm going to talk through Prayer Before Birth, which is my favourite poem out of all 16. I'm not going to read through every single point, but for some of them that are maybe more difficult to understand, I'll speak them through and focus mainly on the strongest points. Okay, so notice straight away we've got this use of anaphora all of the way through. I am not yet born, I am not yet born. Okay, so although the child hasn't even been exposed to the outside world yet, it's already aware of the horrors that awaits it. You'll notice that quite often when I make points, I call it a he. We don't know, it could be a girl or a boy. That's just what I've gone with, just to make it easier. So this almost sounds like an incantation, which is similar to a prayer. So you could say that he is speaking to a higher power, as if they're the only one with power to change humanity as it stands. And we've got these imperatives that, again, is commanding somebody to help or hear me, console me. We have those imperatives again all of the way through. That adds a sense of desperation. He is desperate to be protected before he's even born. I've put here God, but we don't know who the recipient is. It could be God, it could be to his parents, or it could be to humankind. We don't know who the recipient is. So this here, where it's highlighted in yellow, let not the blood-sucking bat or rat or the stoat or the club-footed ghoul come near me. In one sense, you could say this Gothic imagery is associated with maybe childhood fears and being fearful of irrational things, such as a bat or a rat. I mean, it's not necessarily irrational. I wouldn't want a rat to come into my room. But it is. It's this sense of a child being scared of creatures and things. But I think you could argue that there's more to it than that. Could these be more metaphorical? If you think all of the way through, he talks about how his life is being sucked away from him. His humanity is being sucked from him when he enters the world. To the point where at the end of the poem, he's just a cog in a machine, just following other people's orders. So this bit when he's talking about the blood-sucking bat, is he talking about how humankind is what sucks the blood and the life from him? Okay, this next part, I am not yet born, console me. I fear that the human race may with tall walls wall me. Okay, here it has a clear sense of claustrophobia, where he's talking about the walls just completely surrounding him, and the fact that they're tall, emphasising that even more. If you think, he's speaking from the comfort of his mother's womb, and he even sees that as less claustrophobic and walling as he does the outside world, which shows the extent of just how fearful he is to be born into that society. Okay, with strong drugs dope me, with wise lies lure me. As you can even see, I'm struggling to pronounce it. There's so much alliteration, assonance, which I'll talk about in a minute. But here, the wise lies, could he be alluding to war propaganda? We think back to the very start of us starting war photography. That's what I put in the starter about war propaganda, and how they would glamorize it almost. As you were sent off to war, they would sing songs, it would be celebrated, and you were made to feel very patriotic. It was quite glorified, where the reality of that was completely different. So is this what he's talking about? How men are lured to join the war, but it's just built on lies. Okay, so we've got lots here of assonance and alliteration to emphasise their entrapment. The alliteration creates quite a nursery rhyme tone, which although adds to the fact that the speaker is an unborn child, a baby, and we've got the innocence of that is juxtaposed to the actual terror of what he thinks or knows the world is like. Okay, I'm going to look quickly at the repetition of this W sound. We look a lot in class about how different sounds produce different things. So, for example, when we look at plosive sounds, how that can quite sound quite explosive. But the W sound is, it takes quite long for us to actually elongate the sounds. So it slows down the speech here. Tall, walls, wall, me. So that sense of it, if us being slowed down, if it being elongated, adds to this sense of being drug-induced. Maybe that's why the words are being pronounced slowly. So here you could add again, is he literally talking about drugs and the issue with drugs in society? Or is it more metaphorical? And he's been talking about how society is drug-induced because it's going through society's motions. And it's more like they're just playing a part in that society as opposed to being their own person. In this stanza, third one here, I think that it's the only time where he has any sense of hope, or he focuses on some of the positives in society. But this quickly changes. So he talks about water, grass, trees to talk to me, sky to sing to me, the birds. So we've got a semantic field of nature and about its purity. Notice later on though, which I'll look at, is when he talks about nature, it's more as if nature has turned on him. Like humankind, nature is also out to get him. Could this be that once the nature was pure, but humanity has corrupted it? And that's why later on in the poem, nature also, it now seems to be punishing him for that. But in this sense, yeah, it's the only time where there is any sense of hope of what society could be like. He talks about a white light here. Could this be another allusion to God? Light is symbolic of hope, and in order for the world to return to its natural state, a supernatural element is required. Okay, so talking about a white light in the back of my mind to guide me. Is this talking about God guiding him to make the right decisions in society? However, it's as if the strength of humankind is more powerful. And no matter that he's got this guide, he's still going to be corrupted when he's born into the world. Okay, so before he is even born, he is already asking for forgiveness. As if that he can already preempt that when he is born, he is going to have to make decisions, he's going to take actions that will be sinful. And it's almost, this whole stanza is as if that's out of his control. So he says, for the sins that in me the world shall commit. Okay, so notice how he is detaching himself from it. He is the one that's going to commit them, but it's the world's fault. All this way through, notice that me and they is very, very closely connected. So in one sense, he could say that they here is clouding what he has done in detaching himself from blame, or the fact that they is so closely connected to me is that they have the power to override any decisions or actions that he would want to make now that he is just a product of society. My words when they speak me. Okay, so again, he doesn't even have the power to choose what he wants to say. My thoughts when they think me, my treason engendered by traitors beyond me. Okay, so everything, he is powerless in every decision, thought, word that he makes. There's a complete sense of hopelessness. So while here he's asking for guidance, now all of this is being taken away from him. Even though he might have a guide, he can follow that through. My life when they murder by means of my hands. Okay, so he's already, again, predicting that being born, he is going to have to murder. But he's asking for forgiveness for that, as if it's not his fault. Okay, this definitely sounds as if it's alluding to war. Okay, remember that this was written during World War II. So he's saying that, like, look, if I'm born, I'm going to have to join the war. I'm going to have to enlist. I'm going to have to kill people to defend my country. but that's not my fault. That's what I'm being made to do. And it's that he can't seem to deal with. He'd rather not be born than have to live that life. Imagine if me coming from England, if I was in England now, if there was a war going on, would I be terrified for my child to think that they would have to grow up and be a part of that? Okay, so we've got allusion to sins of humanity. It is inevitable that the child will be callous and possibly evil. That is what it seems to suggest. And is it moral for us to have a child and bring it into this world? So there is a semantic field of war. As I've said, it seems very much like he's alluding to war in this fourth stanza. There is a passive tone which resembles this loss of control. Okay, it's like he's not even an active member in his own life. He has no control over it. He's passive. He has just been told what to do, in the sense that he is following orders. His actions within society have already been preordained, which means they've already been decided, and thereby he seems to think that they are not his doing. Okay, so these first two lines here, I'm not yet born, rehearse me, the parts I must play and the cues I must take. Okay, so we've got an extended metaphor here of theatre, or a semantic field of theatre. In your exam though, don't overload how many techniques there are, just go with one. But either way, it's shown us how it's like he's playing a part in society. That's how he is expected to act. It's not really him, he's just playing a part. And it highlights his lack of choice and freedom. If you were to compare this to war photographer, a point of contrast that you could make is where the war photographer is wanting a part within that. He has opted to be a war photographer. He has chosen that job. He is playing a part within that. Here it's a sense that he has been forced to play that part. He uses the verb rehearse. Before he's even born, you're going to have to prepare me and teach me how to play this role within society. That he seems to think he has no job but to perform. We've got modal verbs all the way through of must, which again emphasises his lack of choice, his lack of freedom in society. Okay, he talks about how old men lecture me, bureaucrats hector me. So again about he's not able to make his own decisions, that is then forced upon him. Notice how I said in stanza 3 he talks about the purity of nature and how that can provide for him. Where now the mountains frown at me. It's as if even nature has turned against them. Nature reflects how corrupted humanity's thoughts are. They are unaware of the destruction they are causing. And because of that, maybe nature has turned against them for what they have done to humankind. Lovers laugh at me and white waves wash me to folly and the deserts call me to doom and the beggars refuse my gift and my children curse me. I'll just say this bit first, just to go with the green, which I'd already mentioned. The verb suggests entitlement, assume false wisdom, and control the young. Okay, so him being born is powerless. Bureaucrats are seen as soulless, trying to enforce others into passive compliance. Compliance meaning that they'll just do whatever they're told to, and they'll just go along with it without asking questions. Okay, this part, I'd never really thought about it before until I was thinking about the poem all the other day. When he says, my children curse me. Okay, why is it that he thinks that his children will curse him? Is it because of the man he is forced to become? As we know, what he might have to partake in, whether that's war or murder. Or if you think now this poem is being told from the voice of an unborn child who is terrified of the world and who doesn't seem to want to be born into it. So now is he talking about his children and how the fact that he brings them into this world, that they will then curse him. because they also don't want to be a product of society.